What's up, guys? This is the Quad Episode 4. We got another special guest for you guys. Check us out.
You're tuning into the destination for TV superfan discussion, AfterBuzz TV. And now, let the buzz begin.
Ooh.
Listen.
You can gather this.
Listen.
This is the cut right here. You don't know about this dude. Talking about woke.
You will not be able to
get it.
Y'all better listen. I guess we gotta start the show.
Yeah.
What's up, guys? Episode 4 of the Quad.
Oh, man.
The revolution will never die.
Revolution will not be televised. The revolution will not be televised because the revolution will be live right here.
See, I just wanted TK to do it.
Gil Scott Heron, okay. Look him up.
Hey, keep him woke.
Wait, did Kanye West?
Let's just start the show.
All right. So.
Why?
Let's start with our intros. Ladies first.
I don't know what's happening.
This lady on the far left who kept us woke. Who are you?
Y'all? My name is TK Trinidad. I will also be on the live stream on the YouTube page, The Quad. So make sure hit us up with all your comments, all that stuff. And also, really appreciate all those comments that you guys put after the show, because I know some of you guys don't get it until later on.
They gave
on.
Us love.
Yes. Thank you for the love. Thank you.
We know we earned it.
Yeah, we've been trying. I still got my yellow sheet here.
I got y'all.
So thank you for all the love. You can find me on at Twitter, Instagram, Facebook, all that good stuff, at TK Trinidad.
Hi guys, my name is Ava Hill, and you can find me on Instagram at the Ava Hill.
Nothing else.
We're gonna get it.
We're working on her.
Get Ava together. I'm Lynneisha, guys, and you can find me on Instagram and Twitter at Lynneisha_33.
Yo, I got like another brother here. I don't mean just like black, but like an actual guy. He got locks. I'm like super excited. I got representation today, right? All right, but firstly, I'm DeAnJilo. Follow me on Twitter at DeAnJilo TV or at DeAnJilo on Instagram. But let's talk about our special guest, Mr. Jeff Byrd. Where can they find you?
What's up?
If you guys will, but firstly, before you do what you about to do.
Yes.
Mr. Jeff Byrd is the director of the last two episodes. That will be episode 2 and episode 3.
Yes.
Entitled Invisible Man and Things Fall Apart.
And Things Fall Apart, yes.
Yes. Which were very, very good. So we're glad to have him on the team. But where can they find you? Thank you for joining us.
Thank you for having me, guys. Appreciate it. Let's see. What am I on? I'm on Twitter as at Feather Films. And like Feather like a bird. And Instagram is my name backwards. So it's Byrd Jeff. And Facebook is just me, Jeff Byrd.
And Mr. Byrd,
Actually, let me tell a story first.
Wait. Before you give your story, can I have research that
yes,
I've done?
Yes,
and I would like to research it.
Are you doing an official intro or are you doing questions first?
No questions.
Okay.
You'll get your story.
Gotcha.
I just wanted some projects that Mr. Byrd has been a part of I found.
Got it.
17 Again.
Yes.
King's Ransom.
Yes.
And Jasper, Texas.
Yes.
Very good sounding film. 17 Again is the one that I've seen.
Yeah. That's with Tina Tamara.
And King's Ransom.
King's Ransom, Anthony Anderson.
Mm-hmm. There it
is. So, you know, and we're going to go into some projects that he has that we're actually going to be able to review later on.
Yes.
But he's going to give us more info on that. But I looked that up and I was really excited to read it.
I appreciate that.
Yes.
I appreciate
very talented man. He's been around.
I appreciate the research.
He's been in the game, you know what I mean? So
research is important.
TK, sorry, what was your story that you would love to share?
So my story, it's so funny how like social media, you before social media, you're like 6 degrees of separation. With social media, you're now like 2 degrees of separation.
Okay.
So Jeff Byrd's sister, I don't even think I can give her enough credit, but she, Twinkie Byrd, she like essentially anything black major, I want to say pretty much everything, she's like the major casting agent in LA.
Yes, she's pretty
and
big.
And she's huge, and I had moved to LA I've been here on and off for several years, heard of Twinkie Byrd through other channels, was friends with her on Twitter, never met her in person, ever. Was friends with Jeff on Facebook for at least 7 years.
That's a long time.
Had no idea that legit direct
blood.
Yeah. Not even that. Oh, that you back. you're big yourself. Had no idea. And we're Facebook friends.
She
and I'm like, oh, shoot, I know Jeff. Mm-hmm. I could ask you for a job like 7 years ago.
You could have.
And now I feel like I need to go through each individual Facebook
friend.
Or
people can ask now.
Right.
Or now.
So just first off, lesson learned, anybody who's on social media, it's not a bad thing. You know, not necessarily a network thing, but, you know, use it to your advantage. Sometimes. There's really great people out there. And, you know, I hit up Jeff through Facebook, and thank you for coming on the show.
Thank you for having me, guys. I mean, that's amazing, because, you know what, that's very important, because you're right. Now, more than ever, like, connecting with each other is very important, and social media allows you to do that, and that's kind of crazy. It's kind of like, oh, okay, you just hit me up, and I was like, yeah, I'll do it, sure. And my sister, who, you know, she co-signed it.
Yeah.
And she's never even been here. So I'm like, I thought she was here. She's like, oh yeah, do it, AFTERBUZZ, do it.
Yeah.
She watches, though.
She hit me up on Twitter. Thank God she didn't see the first episode. She hit me up on Twitter after we improved. So thank you guys for helping us improve. Yeah. She hit me up after the second episode on Twitter. And let me know. Aww. So, I mean,
Shout out to Twiggy.
Yeah.
Oh, that's awesome. Yeah. Well, what is your favorite social media platform? Like, what do you think has connected you with different people in the industry? Like, how?
That's a good question. I would probably say Facebook, just because.
Facebook, okay.
Just because I'm admitted right now. I'm admitted on your show.
I
have a hard time understanding Twitter.
Okay.
A little bit. It's just hard for me to figure it out.
Well, and you're better than me. I don't even have an account. So.
Oh, okay. Well, you know what? When you get an account, you'll probably understand it better than I currently do. And it's really hard to do for me. So I'd say Facebook.
Okay.
Facebook and Instagram.
Well, you know, I appreciate that, because a lot of people sleep on Facebook now. It's not like, you know, I hear more so Twitter or Instagram. So.
No, you can't. I mean, it depends on the industry that you're in, and it depends on what you're trying to do. Like, I find with Facebook, it's like, you know, I have one group of, like, entertainment professionals. I have one group of, like, track people. I have one group of CrossFit people. Yeah. And if I need anything, like, you know, whatever, like, oh, I need, that's the first place I go to. Mm-hmm. And then I'll go to Twitter and then Instagram.
Yeah.
So, I mean, it just kind of just depends on, you know, what you do.
Yeah. And also that Facebook Messenger app really helps, because you message.
Oh, right. Yeah.
She sent me in a Facebook Messenger, and I look at all those. And I go, oh, let me see who messaged me.
Who's in that's great to know that you look at all of them, too.
Yeah. Yes. Yeah.
That's great.
Yes.
Well, let's get
cool.
into
yeah,
the
guys,
episode.
We got a show to talk about. But I want to talk to our guests a little bit. It was really interesting hearing some of your comments about the episode, because this isn't a specific episode that you worked on.
I did not direct this episode, no. But my friend Rashad Ernesto Green directed. Shout out to Rashad. That's the man.
So, but let's talk about your process, the episodes that you were working on.
I will give you guys no spoilers.
I hope not.
No spoilers.
I feel like we got close last week.
I tried to get some things out of him when we were watching, and he was not having it.
No, I don't want any spoilers.
Stone face. Y'all not going to get me in trouble. I like y'all, but y'all not going to get me in trouble. I want to direct the show next season. So,
so what was it like to be a part of this project? What was some of the what was the vision that you had, and how do you feel about the finished product?
It was amazing, actually, to be a part of this. So I'm, like, I think outside of Rob Hardy, who's an executive producer on the show, as well as kind of like a co-creator of the show, he directed the Quad movie, and then he directed the first episode, which the Quad, I think the Quad movie, they broke up into two episodes, didn't they?
No, mm-hmm. It was one.
Oh, they left
one,
it in
one episode.
They left it in one.
Okay,
they left it in one, and then he did the first episode after that. And outside of him, I'm the only one that's directed two, like, back-to-back. Mm-hmm. And I was just so happy to be a part of it. It was amazing. I have a history with Rob. We go way back. I have a history with Felicia. I directed Soul Food, the series, back when that was on.
That was in Toronto, right?
That was in Toronto, yeah. Yes. Mm-hmm. And I was up there for month after month after month. So I have a deep, rich kind of relationship with the creators of the show. And my two episodes, I got to do stuff that I really loved. I got to do football. Mm-hmm. I directed the big football game. And then I got to do, like, a really big, rich, deep, dramatic, you know, very juicy kind of in one place. Kind of like usually we call those, like, a bottle episode. Everything happens in one place.
Mm-hmm.
And you know, and the beauty of that is trying to get to master the room and figure out, okay, this action is going to happen there, and how's it going to connect with that action that happened over there, and then back here, and this over here, because we can't shoot it all at once.
Right. Right.
So for me, I always love those moments, because then you really, as a director, you really have to work.
Mm.
You really have to work to remember. You can't just lean on your shot list. You really have to work to try and, you know, stage it all so that it all falls into place nicely.
Yeah.
So I'm I have nothing but great things to say about the quad.
That was something we really noted, just the fact that the last episode was in one setting.
Yeah.
But it was so much going on, and it was all connected.
And also with
conversation.
The flashbacks as well.
Yeah.
So we had that kind of flashbacks.
We had that,
which was pretty cool.
So we really enjoyed it. What I thought was interesting, this is a little thick question, but like, so we saw some aspects of what you shot in this episode from last episode, mm-hmm. and it was the big scene, the rape scene.
Yes.
Potentially rape scene. Mm-hmm. What was that like though? Like from the outside looking in, that's intense. Like what? I mean, just how do you even have that conversation? How do you do that? How are cameras around? Like, you know,
it was rough. It was rough. I mean, you know, shouts out to Jazz. You know, Jazz Recall. She's the truth. And you know, we had to shoot that. Like obviously, there's the version that happened in my episode where you see the wide, but I actually had to go in and shoot all those close-ups that you saw from tonight's episode. And then they ended up using those, mm-hmm. you know, or you know, for the close-ups.
Right. Mm-hmm.
But it was rough. It was hard. I mean, we had to stop and we had to gather ourselves and we had to support Jazz and we had to mm-hmm. you know, really you know, let her know it was okay.
Yeah.
And, I mean,
that's
because tough. That's tough. It's a real thing, and I'm glad that the show in the first season is exploring, you know, things like this.
A lot of issues.
Yeah.
That's an amazing thing to explore in your first season. Usually you wait.
Right.
Yeah. And because you never know what side of the coin someone's going to fall on.
Right.
And the writers and the creators did that purposely to, you know, make it either so you don't know what if it's one or the other, so that people can kind of pick sides and choose sides, and then their mind can be opened up when they find out something else.
Right.
Mm-hmm. Which you'll see probably next episode. So, you know, when you find out what side you're on and was that the right side to be on.
Right.
Mm. And so when we shot it, we didn't even know what side we were on when we kind of shot it. So mm-hmm. we were like, okay, well, so I had to kind of figure out, am I shooting a rape scene or am I shooting a sex scene?
Right.
Or am mm-hmm. I shooting? So, you know, no one would tell me what I was shooting. So I had to figure out, you know, how I was going to shoot it and how to make it both.
Yeah.
How to literally serve two masters
achieved
that.
Mm-hmm.
in the one shoot.
Yeah. I mean, I mean, you can't not see that scene and not feel the type of emotion. And I would imagine that's what you want from your viewers.
Yes. Mm-hmm.
So, very well accomplished. And I think that's a perfect segue to talk about the episode.
I have one question.
Oh, go ahead.
Well, not one question.
I have my segue set up.
I'm sorry.
I was ready, man.
I was ruining things for people. So, you've been in the industry, well, according to IMDb, like since 97. More than that?
Yeah, I was 10 then, and so yes, it's, you know, so it was rough being
10 and directing. How did you get into the industry? Because I know a lot of people, especially living in LA, you have people who say, oh, I want to do this, I want to do that, but then, you know, they're not making any moves towards that, or, you know, is it the luck of the draw, or like, how do you...
That's a great question.
How did you get there, and what you're suggesting to folks?
Well, you know, I don't know. I'm pretty controversial on those answers, so I don't know if you really want me to answer it. But
yeah,
you know,
actually, now we do.
There's no prototypical. Now I want to hear it.
Well, I mean, okay. Well, I'm not the biggest believer in what's for me is for me and all that stuff. I'm actually not a believer in that at all. I believe in what's for you. You have to go after, and you can't just sit at home and meditate on it. Pray on it and all that stuff. No offense to those that do. You have to go after it. And then that's what I did. And that's what worked for me. You know, it started out with Spike. And that's how I was taught. How I got into the business is my dad, way before dreadlocks, way before these locks, my dad and I used to go and get haircuts together. And when I was in college. And he knew I wanted to be in the entertainment industry. And one day we were walking, you know, back to the train in New York. I'm from New York, Brooklyn.
Nice.
Brooklyn went up. Brooklyn in the house. Brooklyn
went
up.
I just moved from New York.
BK, where are you from?
I'm originally from South Carolina, but I just moved from New York in January of last year. But anyway.
My family's from North Carolina. My mom and dad are from North Carolina. I was born and raised in Brooklyn, New York, but they're from North Carolina.
Oh, nice.
So it's interesting. My dad was always me, Twinkie, and my other sisters, because I'm the only boy and his three sisters. He's always very like, you know, you want to do it, then go do it. So one day we were walking home from this haircut, walked by a set, and he was like, oh, there's a set right there. You should go and talk to somebody and get a job.
Nice.
And I was like, hey, Dad, yeah, that's cool, but I'm not going to do that. He was like, yes, you are. We're not moving until you go and do that.
Hmm.
And he was serious. He was dead serious about that. He was like, no. And so I had to go over there and talk to one black guy working on the set. I went and talked to him. Beeline right over to him. One black guy.
Did you give him the head nod?
We locked eyes. And I was like, hey, okay, I can do it. So I went and I talked to him. He's like, look, I'm just shooting some inserts for a show. But you know what? I work for Spike Lee. I'm his gaffer, and we're about to start a movie. So here's a number. You should call him and go in and meet.
Nice.
And that's what happened. I called them, and I wear this suit, and I go in to meet, and they were like, hey, you, grab that box. Follow us. Do this, do that, and the other thing. And I ended up staying where I ended up working there.
What movie was it?
Mobile Blues, Jungle Fever, and Malcolm X.
Yes. Wow. How you just casually say
wow.
that?
Wow. Those were the Denzel years.
I'm talking about speaking of
those. Man, those were the Denzel years. So I worked on all three of those films and all the music videos and commercials and stuff in between.
That's amazing.
So that's kind of how I did it. And then literally, you know, I had to work to stay in the camp and do all those things. It was crazy. So for me, it's literally about, like what you did. You sent me a message to me and said, okay, I'm going to reach out to Jeff and see if he'll come do a show. And I'm like, yeah, I'll come do the show. It's great. So for me, that's what it's about. It's about people having, because I think a lot of people, they think they want it, mm-hmm. but their skin is very thin. Mm-hmm. And so when they hear one no or oh, well, I text him and he never texts me back, so forget it. Or I emailed him and never gave me back, forget it. And then they give up. And this is about, okay, well, I'm going to hit it again. And also have something new to say when you hit me up. Have something new to talk about or have something new to show.
Right.
Mm-hmm. Don't hit me up with the same
like
thing.
Like you've been doing
one
yeah.
single time. I don't want to, you know what, I didn't look at that thing the first time. I'm not going to look at it now.
So different headshots every time you hit them up.
Well, I'm actually taking my agency and I'm actually having to take new ones on the 25th. So.
That's good.
We might not get it to the end of the show till later. You're also, because we're actually, so special announcement, guys. After the quad is over, we're actually going to all be the hosts for Rebel.
Mm-hmm.
And
she's a director for
you're the director.
Yes. We didn't
the
plan
EP
it.
Is actually John Singleton.
Plan it.
And in my mind, when I think of Spike Lee, I also think of John Singleton. I was talking to a friend as I was walking in. I was like, you don't understand, like, as far as like black movies go, and there's a whole bunch of there's great mm-hmm. folks there, but when I like it's just when I think of Spike Lee, I think of Johnson. I they so much great work.
That is true.
So yeah. What is like, have you been, were you able to work with him, or what was that experience like?
Well, I've known John for years. We're both the co-chairs of the African American Steering Committee at the DGA. So, but I've known him for years now, and but I've never worked with him. We never worked together. Mm-hmm. So this was the first time doing Rebel. I directed the season finale of Rebel mm-hmm. and the episode right before that. So episode 9 and 10 I directed. And this is actually my first time directing a season finale. So that's new.
Okay, nice. Congratulations.
So yeah. we'll get you on for that one too, right?
Yeah, I'll come back.
Sure. We got it on video.
I will definitely come back.
I mean, we would love to have you.
That show is going to be incredible. Just like the quad. The quad. Rebel is going to be.
I think it's going to have a lot more controversy.
It probably will.
Yeah.
I just think BET's doing some really good things right now. These new shows are really, really good, and it's really, you know,
well
really coming with some heat.
Well, they're drawing me in because I was not. Like the content was not drawing me; it didn't interest me. But this show, The Rebel, like their rebranding is going very well.
Definitely,
very well. I'm so happy.
Yeah.
And the quad was a great introduction to that for me as a director, because you know, you want to direct juicy stuff. You want to direct great people. I mean, who's greater than Anika Noni Rose and Ruben Santiago-Hudson? Two Tony Awards right there, standing in front of your face. So you're going, okay, how am I going to direct these two Tony Award winners?
I mean, we're here, so I mean, we might as well. We just had you talk about one of your future projects. Are there other projects or other things that you'd like to share with the audience to check out?
Well, actually, you know what? Just Tuesday, it just passed. I directed an episode of Switched at Birth, which just aired. It's their it's the fifth episode for season 5, and it's their racism episode where the black students took center stage, and literally the whole episode is told from the black actor's perspective.
Wow. Mm.
And it's been getting a lot of buzz. It's been getting a lot of AfterBuzz. It's been getting a lot of AfterBuzz, and the Hollywood Reporter did an article on it. TV Guide did an article on it. So it's getting a lot of critical acclaim. So I'm really happy.
Nice.
I'm really
That's cool.
And excited. Yeah. So it's Switched at Birth. If you guys want to check it out.
Got it.
On the Freeform app.
I was gonna say it's Freeform, right?
Yes, that's Freeform. Check it out.
If you've seen
app.
Anything from his work, it's worth checking out. The last two episodes of Carl was bomb.
Thank you. I appreciate that. I got to do a show where I can blow something up. Now that's my next. My
next
goal
is
to do a show where I can blow something up.
I love it. Well, look, you know, we're a couple minutes in, guys.
Yeah. let's talk about the show.
Well, look. We can't not talk about the controversy. That happened. We saw the video of the last episode, and this episode, we already know that Sydney was involved in the incident, and she revealed that her view is that she was raped. How did you guys feel about how she was acting throughout the episode, how she was processing it? just this, to give y'all a specific name, like the scene in the classroom where she's just there. Mm-hmm. She kind of zones out and is thinking about it or how she's interacting with Madison.
Right. I think she goes through the emotions. Like, she first didn't want to admit it to herself. Mm-hmm. Because I kind of think if the video didn't come out, she might have tried to tuck it away until it, like, represented itself in a different form later on. So the video came out, now it forced her to relive it again. So then she's trying to forget it. Now she's in the classroom. Now she sees it. She's going through all these emotions. It's, you know, essentially the same, not the same emotions, but, you know, if they're going through a divorce or somebody cheats on it. It's like all these, so she can kind of see all these emotions throughout the show. So I think it was really accurately portrayed. As versus, you know, oh, this is what happened. Now I'm angry. Right. You know, it's like, that's what I really like about the quad, and I really like about AfterBuzz, is that because watching the shows for the after shows, I'm paying way more attention to detail.
Yeah.
So all these little things that I probably would have never caught sitting on the couch just watching TV, I now am more appreciative of directors and writers and everybody who puts the work in, because now I'm like, okay, I see the connection.
You're not just consuming, you're looking for
exactly
the stylistic. Yeah,
because just like while I was like kind of writing and taking those notes at the same time, and I'm like, she's like not, it's like she doesn't want to face it, you know, when she's talking to Madison about it, and just kind of dismiss it. And as soon as she leaves the room, she's like tearing things up in the closet. My note was like, oh, she doesn't act like it didn't happen. Okay, she's facing it, she's dealing with it in her own way, but she's trying to save face at the same time still. But then behind closed doors is when she explodes, when she kind of lets go and shows her anger towards it.
You guys think she was being kind of, you know, I'm sorry, I didn't mean to interrupt.
No,
I just thought, you know, we have three lovely, beautiful women on the show, on this panel. I think it's great. And I was just wondering, with you guys' experience in college or just in school coming up, I mean, did you guys ever, like, have any moments of, like, over drinking, or I mean, I'm just going just from the history of Sydney and that whole over drinking thing. Like,
I don't know, sleep. But part of me wants to give the politically correct answer to that.
No,
I won't do that. And I'm actually glad that you asked that question, because, you know, I was looking more so at Sydney's. I was wondering the entire time what she did to as an actor to kind of to deliver something like that in the correct way, because for me, I automatically felt overwhelmed looking at the arch of her character in this episode, because, you know, she's having to portray someone that's actually been in that position the correct way, you know, because people who that has happened to, they have to look at that and connect with that. And so since I have not had that exact experience, I was asking myself, what would you have done in this episode? What would you have, what would your, I guess, steps, what would the steps that you would have taken to I guess, deliver that correctly? So with that being said, I have, I did drink plenty, in college.
She's being around the bush now.
Right? I'm not gonna lie. I did that.
You dabbled, huh? You dabbled a little bit?
I did.
In the drink.
But you know, listen, my mom and dad told me, look, we don't care what you do, as long as you make good grades and graduate on time, because once 2009 passes, there's nothing we can do for you.
Right.
As long as you do what you came there to do, we don't really care, you know, what else you do. And so I was like, okay, cool. So I mean, yeah, I had nights where, you know, it was scary or blacked out or, you know, whatever. But you know, looking at that, when you're not really in control of yourself and something like that can happen to you, that's extremely scary. I mean, I don't know what you would think that, to me, a rule when it comes to drinking is you should always be around people who you can trust.
Right. Yeah.
And who can take care of you. And, you
but
know.
If you're all drinking, then.
And then, right. And I was like, right.
Just to tap in, like I would say, like, I felt like I was kind of that person while I was in college.
Because
I was a little too scared to get too drunk. So there were that times where it's like, okay, my friend is too drunk to be dancing with you too much. Or, like, where are you guys going? And guys would get upset. Oh, she knows what she's doing.
Yeah.
No, she does not. Yeah. She's my friend.
Right.
I know her
good.
Personality. Like,
right.
She's done.
Right.
Like,
and you were there to take care of her.
And it's like, it's surprising and it's scary that a guy would be like,
No, right. She's coming with me. What are you doing?
See, that's the problem, though. For me, it was a totally different experience because I was an athlete, so we couldn't afford to do that.
Yeah.
And on the flip side, because I really hope I instill this in my kids, I had a very healthy fear of my mother to this day, to the point where there's things I do, things I say, even published works or even what I say on here. It's just like, I don't want that phone call, like, why did you do this? And my mom was all the way in Toronto. So, like, in college, it was like, that's not happening. And for me, even though you might feel safe around a group of individuals at a party, that still is an unsafe environment.
Right.
Mm-hmm. So I never really, I mean, I don't get me wrong, I love to drink.
Yeah.
But I was that chick who would buy, you know, Mad Dog 2020 in Oregon.
Oh.
Mad Dog 2020. I was that chick who would buy, like, Mad Dog 2020, and I'll go home after practice, cook something, and I'll watch TV.
Right.
Like, because that's safe environment for me. But if I was at a party or something like that, it's like, I know you guys, but, you know, if this chick is over here, because we used to travel and my homegirls would party and then leave with some dude. I'm like, okay, I found myself driving through Portland looking for my homegirl because her phone died. Yeah. It's like, I would never be in that situation because I was just too paranoid.
And I mean, you really have to take care of yourself. I mean, for me, like, I've never completely blacked out. You know, but, like, I have been in situations where, you know, I had to teach myself, like, okay, after, like, three drinks, mm-hmm. you need to, like,
right.
mm-hmm. you need to let it, you need to slow down. So I've never been completely unconscious of what was going on around me, because part of me was, like, you always need to know what's going on around you at all times. Yeah. Mm-hmm. However, you know, having alcohol, period, you know, you're kind of letting yourself go. Mm-hmm. And so in that sense, you know, you do really have to mind what's going on.
Right.
And, you know, I've been in places where my friends have been in trouble and I've had to, you know what I mean? And so seeing it happens.
This is where privilege plays a role too.
Yeah.
Because the thing is, Sydney has been in such a privileged situation that even if she were to get arrested or something like that, her mom knows people who knows people. For me, in my situation, if something happens, I get arrested, that's a wrap.
Right.
So I think take out race out of the issue. Privilege plays a huge role. That's why you see, you know, celebrities, not all of them, but you see celebrities making these stupid calls. And you're like, why would they do that? Well, because they have a lawyer and they have a PR agent and they have all these people that will, you know, make it happen.
Well, I thought one of the interesting things that you guys said was the importance of support system.
Mm-hmm.
So Madison, who is her support system.
Which I'm so proud of her, by the way.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Okay, yeah, that's why I'm wondering how did you guys
show last week.
Because
she really did not care. She didn't care what Sydney was going to do to her. She didn't really... She wasn't that friend that said, you know what, I should do this mm-hmm. for Sydney, but I'm not going to because I'm afraid of what Sydney's going to do. She mm-hmm. said, nope, I don't care how mad Sydney is.
Yeah.
I'm going to be her friend. I'm going to be there for her.
She brought the girls over.
And so when that happened, I was even taken aback because I was mm-hmm. like, oh my gosh, like what is Sydney going to do? What if this is the end of their friendship?
Yeah.
You know, what if this was it being too intrusive?
Mm-hmm.
But, you know, because Sydney and, you know, they are really the only friend that's, I don't know, maybe the only friend that she has on campus, kind of,
that she's
opened herself up to. I think that was her role to do that for Sydney, whether she liked it or not.
Right.
So I mm-hmm. was...
Because if she didn't like it and she essentially shut her out, 5 years, 2 years, 1 year later, she can never say that she didn't have my back.
Right.
So, if you do your part and you just mm-hmm. like, hey, I did this, whatever.
That's a real friend.
That's a real friend.
Even when Sydney tried to kick her out, mm-hmm. when she tried to kick Madison out of the door,
which was hilarious.
And I mean, for me, I don't know if I would have tried to help Sydney, but I don't know if I would have gone as far as bringing the other two girls in the room,
mm-hmm.
you know, because I would have been afraid. Like, I don't know what Sydney's going to do. I don't know how she's going to react. So
Sydney's not hood now. So, I mean, she could be a bit much.
Yeah, she can be a lot, you know, and listen, I know how it is to live with people in close corners. You know mm-hmm. what I mean? And so you that have too. To get along. With your, listen, I was performing for 10 weeks and stayed in a room with three of the girls, okay? So you have to, you know, you have to know how to,
And also, like, her mom's the president of school.
So she'd be like, Mommy,
I need a new roommate. She got to get
her. Right, exactly. And mm-hmm. so that's what I thought she was going to do. And she was like, you can leave. You know what I mean? And so me putting myself in that situation, I would have thought, you know what? I need peace when I get to my dorm. I don't want any drama.
Mm-hmm.
So I'm not going to bring these girls into our dorm, right. but I will be there for her nonetheless, yeah. I think is what I would have done. So kudos to her, because
that's bold.
That was bold.
Yeah. I'm glad you said that, because that helps with my segue. On the other side.
I'm here to help. That's what I'm here for. I'm here to help.
I need the representation.
Dreadlock brothers, here together. Here to help.
So look. Like, on the other, you got that happening on one side. On the other side, you have her mom dealing with a different type of pressure when it comes to this case. Mm-hmm. It's standing up for it and taking it seriously. Mm-hmm. I saw a lot about her in this episode and her dynamic with Ella Grace, mm-hmm. aka Jasmine Guy from Different World. So I'm glad to see her in it. You know what I mean? Because when I first... I won't go too much of a tangent, but when I heard of a HBCU show, I always think of Different World.
Yeah, so I mean, that was both. Almost like the original.
Yeah, they finessed that. I like that. So, one, we saw her standing up for it, but it wasn't, people didn't have an issue. Well, some people had an issue with her standing up for it, mm-hmm. but her close friend, the person that she trusts, didn't have a problem with her standing up for it, more so on how she is handling her business. How do you guys feel about their dynamic? Because I want to touch on that a little bit, because it's the first time we've really seen them have an in-depth conversation in the way they have. Mm-hmm.
She's almost like she's essentially the equivalent of Madison, because Dr. Fletcher really trusts her opinion. She's been there for a long period of time, and on top of that, she gives it how it is. Mm-hmm. She's not sugarcoating anything. She knows that she's not there to steal her job, mm-hmm. and you know, she's very upfront and honest. So, I mean, I love the fact that she was honest in saying, you know, everybody thinks you're a Yankee. And you need that sometimes, because it's not necessarily...
like the voice of reason.
Yeah, the voice of reason. So, you know, I don't necessarily know if she's going to buy into it and start serving tea next week. But in the back of her mind, at least she knows that. Yeah, because if she comes into another situation, she might remember that and then back off and then approach it from a different way.
Well, I like it. Well, I mean, she might be one of my more favorite characters after seeing her dynamic. Because she's a person... with her relationship, she doesn't have a personal agenda as much. She wants to see the school succeed.
Right. Mm-hmm.
She doesn't need the credit for herself. And I just like that also they're at the level where Dr. Eva Fletcher, she listens to her. Mm-hmm. She's willing to take the criticism. Yeah. And she doesn't have many people like that in her circle. So I think she's going to be really important for her going forward. Mm-hmm.
Mm-hmm. What do you think about all this so far?
The show or this?
I
think you guys are great. I think this is an amazing dynamic that you all have.
Phenomenal. Thanks.
And as far as the show is concerned, I think I'm interested in, you know, how you guys feel about the you know, the Ella character and also the beginning thing of her firing the security detail.
Yeah.
And I was interested in what you guys think about that.
And also without Dr. Fletcher knowing that it was Sydney yet. You know what I mean? So just taking that stance to say, well, this is important to me, that from my view, it looks like this woman, this young lady was assaulted. Mm-hmm. And for you to be so careless about that, like, I kind of like that. And I know the men or something, like, you're just too quick at the draw. You know what I mean? Mm-hmm. To shoot or react to something. But I felt that way because here... it seems like it's kind of gender comes to play in that, because here's a woman looking at it and then here's a man like, you know, they were probably just having sex.
I think the problem is if you take what's happened in the world and you apply it to the show, you have some situations where you have people crying wolf. Mm-hmm. So, you know, some people's careers, like I can think of a lot of athletes' careers that were ruined because a woman said this and it turned out to be a lie, and now essentially their possibility of going pro or wherever is no longer there because she chose
that. That's why opening this conversation on the show is very, very important, because especially at college, that culture, sexual rape culture, is a lot of pressure on both sides, men and the woman. Of course the woman, and having to, if she was raped, admit it, have those conversations, deal with that type of pressure. Mm-hmm. And on the guy's side, if he didn't do it, that the type of pressure that have to, like, you know, you saw how everyone's eyes changed towards the quarterback.
Right,
when, you know what I mean? Dealing with that, the type of pressure that comes with that.
So, wait, was
really
that Terrence? Because I
know that was Terrence.
Always say me.
Terrence, man.
So,
and he was on a roll, too.
He was killing it.
Yeah. So, like you said, that goes to that point, though, because he is on a roll. He's a quarterback. He's the famous quarterback of that school.
Right. Mm-hmm.
So what if it turns around and it wasn't a rape? You know what I mean? Right. And now his reputation. So, it's a thin line.
Sports is pretty big. I mean, you know, I played football in college, and, you know, there's a lot of pressure there. Mm-hmm. There's a lot of pressure there.
You're the quarterback, too?
Yeah. I was the quarterback. I was a middle linebacker, but it's a lot of pressure to also score with the ladies. Mm-hmm. A lot of pressure at school.
Right, but mm-hmm. I kind of feel like, I don't know about HBCUs, I can speak about Oregon. I kind of feel like you don't really need to do that much. Like, the fact, I mean, I don't know whether, let's just say for this point, it wasn't rape, right? Mm-hmm. He scores with essentially the president's daughter. I don't know if that was his angles. Like out of all the girls, I'm scoring with the president's daughter. I can check that mark. I can check that off. Or he just found an easy lay. But I feel like as athletes, from what I've seen, getting laid as a football player is not a hard task. So.
See, but that's you being judgmental a little bit.
I can admit it.
And honestly, I'm just saying, because you know what's funny? You come to find out that a lot of athletes are very self-conscious and not confident because they identify solely with what they can do on a basketball court or football field.
And they have to live up to what you just said. A lot of people feel that way.
And outside of that, you find out that a lot of them don't have any game. They can't talk to a woman.
Oh, yeah.
They have nothing. Yeah. Only thing they have is, hopefully the girl will just get with me because I scored a touchdown.
Right.
So, I play football, I scored a three-pointer, and I'm the basketball guy. Mm-hmm. And a lot of them, just in a regular conversation.
Oh, terrible.
Yeah.
Terrible.
Yeah.
But also it's because, and not because of all my ball players watching, and not for lack of trying.
Right.
It's because as an athlete, you're so focused on that sport that a lot of social stuff gets left behind.
Yeah, your developmental skills as far as social circles. Like it took me a long time to learn how to network, because I could care less. I didn't want to talk to you. I didn't want to talk to you. If you didn't talk, you had nothing to talk about track or this class that's coming up. I had no interest.
Yeah.
And I regret it now, and I wish I had that skill of networking, because Oregon is such a great school as far as we have so many people beyond sports that I see now. And
of Nike.
Yeah. What school did you go to?
I went to this little small school in Jersey called Ramapo College.
And then you played middle linebacker for them.
Yes.
Nice. All right. Cool. Nice.
Wow. So.
Wow.
We got time. I'm happy about because I want to talk about Cedric and Ebony Weaver. We saw a little bit more of their relationship.
I can't.
And I have a special connection for what's happening, because I feel like somebody said something about this last week, maybe.
I did.
Maybe he was attacked for being correct, which is funny. It's just interesting.
Well, I don't think you're correct, so it's not proven yet.
Wait. last week's episode?
Well, no. I explained it to you. Don't worry. So,
I didn't do it. What happened?
Here we go.
I had an inkling in my heart that maybe Cedric and Ebony had a deeper connection because he was going out of his way to make sure that she was okay.
Right. Oh, okay.
I was like, maybe they may end up together, or at least close friends. And I was attacked by these beautiful females that
you were attacked.
But did you die?
You ladies attacked him.
But did you die?
You ladies attacked him.
And the special guest that maliciously
attacked
him.
But are you here?
The PR lady, she was sitting right there.
He's energetic. He's smiling. No one touched him.
He is emotionally scarred. He's emotionally scarred. I can feel his pain. He's emotionally scarred.
Thank you. All right, I'm just saying, I'm happy to have you here. So,
oh my God!
So what we saw was them having a bit of a connection. I just want to know.
I think the whole dorm situation where she was like, "Can I stay?" I think something's gonna happen.
Was she like that?
But he
said, "I did." She said, "Can I?"
But he stayed. He stayed on the floor.
She knew what she was doing.
Yeah, no, there's nothing wrong with that. And I never said that they didn't have a close connection. What it sounded like you were insinuating, like they're gonna have a relationship.
That's why I asked you.
Do you have any friends who are girls?
Right. And you're like, why did you ask that? You insinuated that every girl that I talk to, I want to have sex
with. I didn't insinuate. I was just asking a question. Are you telling us something?
Are you telling us something? I know what it felt. I know what the question felt like. All right.
Exactly. That's the problem.
It may not be what you intended, but it's what came.
See,
across.
And then that's a good segue.
So do you have any female friends?
Yes, I have a lot.
That you have?
I hope I have three right here.
Okay.
I mean,
that was a good one. That was a good one.
That's a good one. Technically, we're acquaintances. I think after we can be friends.
What?
But DeAngelo and I are pretty. We're pretty good friends.
Yeah, but
I mean,
like,
we hang
you
out
sleep
outside
on the floor of his apartment, or
if I needed him, I'd be like DeAngelo.
Now, do you like lay on his lap while you're watching TV? Like, how close?
No, I would not do that.
Wait, did she lay on his?
That's different. That's not my girlfriend.
No, but sometimes friends do that too. That's why I'm asking if you have girlfriends.
No, but I feel like,
there are certain things that men do that kind of separate the extreme friend zone females and the I'm kind of interested in you. And I think, I don't know, he went to the hospital. He,
I don't see. I just think he likes
it. Well, that's what
wait, so why is that? Why is that? Why is that?
Uh-oh.
No, I'm just wondering. He went to the hospital. I'm just wondering, why is that true?
I have tons of male friends. I think that if something happened to me in the hospital, they would not, they'd probably text me, but I don't think they would come and be like.
See, that's the difference.
But if they did, if one did you think, would you be like, oh, he's interested in me? Immediately, would that the first thing come to your mind?
It depends on who the guy is.
Yeah, see?
It depends on the guy.
I have a friend who like checks on me sometimes depending on the situation, and he'll like send a text or a call, or he stopped by the other day, and it's not that type of thing. That's just his personality.
Right.
So I don't think like, oh,
I don't
my
know.
Gosh,
I just feel like there's always been a bond between Cedric and Ebony, though.
Well,
I
think it's organically happening the way it should happen. Mm-hmm. He's
look, when she asked, can I stay? She's on the bench.
No, you keep doing that. You keep doing that.
But wait. I'm just saying.
But aren't you supposed to? Isn't it like the whole concept is to be in a relationship with your best friend? Isn't that the whole thing?
And they're just building that friendship.
Yes and no, because then people say that there's no such thing as having a male that's your best friend.
Well, then yeah. You're right, because I have a female who's my best friend. She's my best friend of all time.
And there's never been...
Never been, even though everybody always thinks they're...
It depends.
I think
it can happen.
And it's the maturity.
I've had a hard
sides.
Time True. Finding that. Most of them are like,
we'll be friends.
I'm a little interested. I'm like, no, I just want to be friends. Yeah. And so there's more guys on that end than men that I'm actually friends with that it's just like, no, we're friends.
Well, then you know what that means, right?
I don't know what that means.
You know what that means. Maybe the problem is you.
Ooh.
I'm just wondering. No, I'm just wondering.
Thank you for tuning in, guys. He just came for me.
No. Ava. No, Ava.
This is a compliment.
I'm just wondering what you're giving off. Maybe you're giving off.
Is this Dr. Phil or AfterBuzz? wait, what do you mean? What do you mean? What am I giving off?
Like maybe you're inherently, you know.
Your energy.
Your energy is just inherently receiving and sensual and, you know.
Flirtatious?
I would say flirtatious. Maybe not flirtatious. Maybe, because that's a specific. I'm just talking about the inherent you.
Yeah, they might misinterpret. Because that's the thing, if you look at Eva and she did the video talking about, you know, rape, essentially what happens is she's taking either a situation that's happened to her or how she feels, because we're all experiences.
Yes.
The reason we say things or do things or whatever, we're all experiences up to this point in our life. So she's taking that and she's saying it's rape. Or she's in her mind, she thinks it's rape. That's why she did the video. Mm-hmm. If, for instance, she didn't feel that way, then she wouldn't have done the video. You see what I'm saying? So it's like we're all applying the Cedric and thing. It's just like, I don't see it. I think they're really great friends.
I wasn't saying a negative about you. I was just saying in regards to the fact that you're the common denominator with all the guys that you that are, you know.
Well, I'm making it seem I have like 20 guy friends. I actually don't. But
the guys that
she needs a man, y'all.
Right. No, I don't. No, I really don't. No, 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 no.
Instagram.
No,
at
no,
Eva.
No.
TK is killing you.
You won't get it if you go on Twitter.
She's killing you right now. She's killing you right now.
No, I am focused on my career.
I gotta check your Instagram. I'm gonna watch all the Instagram people just start to.
I am focused on my career. Do not DM me.
Check your DMs right now. They're going crazy right now.
No, don't.
It's going down in your DMs right now.
I can't.
It's going down.
I hate everyone in this room. But no, I mean, I have always, you know, I've always tried to make it clear in my friendships with guys, if I'm not interested, I will let you, like, I am not interested.
I don't know if I'm believing you.
Can we talk about guys? Speaking of sex,
you are my friend. Can you speak up for me? Have you seen me be clear with someone if they're like, I'm not. Yes, you have. Stop.
Okay, well, but
yes.
I'm not talking about getting to. Okay.
Yes.
But I'm not talking about. But I'm not talking about getting to that point. I'm talking about the point before that.
Seems like you need to lay on
somebody. Because when you have to tell somebody, then it's obviously become obvious.
Yeah, it's already there.
But I'm talking about the time before that. Like even just
guys,
the little stuff.
Sometimes guys see what they want to see.
Right. That's true.
I will say that.
Yeah, say it again for the people in the back. Say it again for the people in the back.
20 times.
Then they have everybody attacking her.
But you know what?
And I'm not attacking her. I'm just trying to say.
But you know what? I think that we can say that about both men and women, though. I think that
Ava is so cute.
It has begun.
But I just think that we do that as
people. He could be a baller. You could be a baller.
No.
I gotta go.
Are they a casting director? Are they a casting director? Other than that, whatever. But I will say, we as people, we do that. We only pay attention to things that we want to see.
I feel like
with Ebony and Cedric, maybe we feel
is this a segue? Yes.
Maybe we feel as if from what we've seen that maybe there is something more there, because I personally feel that way. I think there's a genuine connection, as men, you know, I feel like if a man really wants you, he will pay close attention to detail of what's going on in your life. And I mean, hey, he showed up to the hospital. And now, you know, my friends that are guy friends, like, okay, if I was in the hospital, I wouldn't expect DeAnJilo to come to the hospital. I would expect him to text me. No, you would not. Stop it.
And what if he did come?
I'd be like, what's up? Glad you're here. But I'm.
Oh, why'd you have to grip him up like that?
Because that's what it is. But.
Is that the stay in your place grip? Like,
yeah. Like, you know.
She doing this too. You know,
literally, with IVs, I'd make sure we did our thing. I'm just saying.
With her butt out. She's getting that.
You see what you want.
I'm just saying. I mean, don't you think? I mean, he came to the hospital. He called her to make sure she was okay. He made sure that they went out to celebrate. You know what I mean? Like, I just think, you know.
I have female friends that I would do that with, and that does not mean I want to sleep with them.
I was going to say, I think it could be one of those things where it can go either way.
Right.
I don't
think they're thinking about that, right? Yeah. I think they just have a genuine connection.
Yeah. No, I think it'll be more.
Well, it could be, but maybe they are in the moment of the friendship.
His girlfriend did just die.
Well,
someone knows the answer in this room.
I'm not saying nothing.
Well, let's go to
a segue.
Ebony and Ebony and Noni.
Well, that's what I'm gonna say. Speaking of not interested in anything.
Oh, God. So I will say just how this last topic touched his heart.
That touched your heart?
This subject.
She's been going on for the last couple weeks.
This subject touched my heart because I said last week, I said last week that it was wrong of Noni to do what she did. And everyone was like, well,
which thing?
When she took her place on the break. And I thought, as a friend and as a roommate, because that's a whole nother level, she shouldn't have done that. And so I was kind of like a one-man band on this panel, because everyone else was like, hey, but if you really wanted a spot, And
let's take ourselves back when we were like in college. Wouldn't you have done it?
No.
We gave her a scenario where she said
you know why?
She probably would have done it.
You know why? Because of the way that I will say.
I'm going to go you one better.
Okay.
Because maybe it's the band stuff you can't relate to.
They already did the acting.
Did they do that? They did that.
She stuttered, though.
I don't know.
Did she stutter?
Yeah, she stuttered. She thought about it. And that was the point.
You know, coming from my uncle is literally calling me as we speak right now. Just coming from.
Because he's seeing your Instagram. your Instagram blowing up right now.
No, but just coming from my childhood and always kind of wanting solid friendship, I take friendship very seriously because it's hard to find loyal friends.
Yeah.
And if I met someone, you know, especially in college, when you're, you know, college is tough. I mean, those are years that you're growing up, like you know, you're coming into your adulthood and you're learning how to socialize, like, outside of great.
We just so not even seeing
you. But I just feel like
every week.
No, I feel like, you know.
What sign are you?
I'm a Virgo.
Oh, man.
Mm. Oh, I'm
a Libra. Well,
I just feel like I would have taken that very seriously, and now I would not have taken her spot.
Ebony Weaver appears to agree with you.
Thank you.
I think this is a great conversation, but I think we got to go. Yeah. Okay. I want you guys to say where you could be followed, especially Miss Ava.
Are you team Ava or are you team
everybody
the panel?
Else?
Okay.
We'll get into it next.
Oh,
week.
That's hilarious.
Yeah.
That's actually funny.
Yeah, I think we have a lot of issues, and on that
we have a lot of issues.
Because this one, all I say is with that.
I'm a real friend.
With that situation, Noni should have called her.
That's all.
Ebony had a right to be upset at her because she had no idea
she
what's happened.
Yeah.
So
right.
I'll give her
and
that.
And even
one.
In this episode, when Noni was like, "Well, it wasn't your spot when you after you left," like,
right.
"Oh, girl, that was not the thing to say."
So, thank you, Jeff. But I'm
thank
sure.
Thank you so much for coming.
Oh, thank you.
Thank you guys for having me. Thank you guys for having me. I appreciate it.
So, a couple of things. Shout out to Twinkie Bird. She's actually watching right now.
Is she watching?
Yes. So thank you. Thank you.
Do you agree with me?
She's going to be sending you a headshot very soon. Also, shout out to Todd, Jametta Black, Michelle Johnson, Steffi Poo, Cash Kane, all you guys for giving us your opinions on the show. It's been really, really helpful. You're making us better, so keep on the comments. We all have, well, three of us have thick skin out.
I have a thick skin!
I'm not so sure about this one, and if you can send her DMs, but all that other stuff.
TK is killing you.
She's killing
it. I'm not
killing her. Did you know what? I love her.
This ain't the longest sign off.
My name is TK Trinidad. You can find me at TK Trinidad on everything. Just the letters TK Trinidad, like the country.
Okay, thank you guys for watching. My name is Ava Hill. Do not DM me. You can find me on Instagram at the Ava Hill. Don't DM me.
DM Ava, and you can find me.
Mike Augustine, Team Ava.
No,
you guys can find me at Lynneisha _33 on Instagram and Twitter.
Follow the Ava Hill.
Hilarious.
All right, follow me, DeAnJilo at DeAnJilo TV.
I hate you guys.
Dr. Byrd, I want to call you Dr. Byrd now.
Hey, I love it. I'll be a doctor. I love it. I'll be a Dr. Byrd.
Thank you so much for joining us. One, follow, leave comments on YouTube, as TK just said. iTunes, if it's less than 4 stars, don't leave anything because we don't like that stuff.
5 stars.
5 stars, 4 stars is okay, I guess. May, thank you for joining us.
Yes.
I think we got to have you. Appreciate
you. Have to come back.
Yeah, you really have to come back.
Rebel coming up. Rebel coming up. I'm back for Rebel.
Hey, thank you for joining us, guys. Catch you guys later.
From executive producers Maria Menounos, Kevin Undergaro, Phil Svitek, and the entire AfterBuzz TV staff, we would like to thank you for listening to the AfterBuzz TV Network. To watch or listen to other after shows and post comments or questions, be sure to visit AfterBuzzTV.com. I'm Sir Richard Wentworth, and this has been a presentation of AfterBuzz TV.
Buzz you later.
The views expressed herein are those of the hosts only and do not necessarily reflect the views of AfterBuzz TV or its owners or principals.